Welcome to Trade Talks Season 2. The title of this trade talk is How Technology Can Reduce the Inherent Risks of Physical Trade and Solve Industry Pain Points. Thank you for being patient. Well done, all of our panelists, for staying there and looking pretty during the 5-minute holding time. We're all ready to go now. So first of all, welcome to all of our attendees today. Thank you for signing up. It's not long now until the holiday period, but we think it's a good time for us to plant some seeds of thought for you over the next few weeks. And so we brought together a great panel of people from around the technology in commodities industry to discuss some of the most important points around what pain points we have in the industry and how technology can be used to resolve them. Key objectives of this webinar are to bring together these experts and understand better where we are within the technology cycle and what technology can do to help these pain points in the physical commodities industry. Now, we've been through technology cycles in the past. Someone very intelligent once said, if you want to know the future, look at the past. We went through the dot-com boom, a lot of hype, a bubble, disillusionment, and then survival and great successes of those companies that delivered a product for a use case. And that's likely what we're seeing with our emerging technologies now. We're currently coming out of that disillusionment phase where some products that had a lot of investment may not make it, but those that have applied their technology to a real use case and a real pain for our industry are going to take off. And that's what we want to discuss today. What are the key success factors there? What are the pain points that we can solve? And how are we going to do it? Interoperation is going to be a key theme of today's talk. And we're going to introduce the different panelists shortly, all of whom have come together as kindred spirits to make their services connect for our customers and deliver added value through that process. What I want to do now is give a brief introduction to everyone who's on the panel, and everyone here is going to have an opportunity to deliver a 1-minute pitch about what their company does before we move into the content of the discussion. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to kick off with Matthew Bertel. Matthew, hello, you're COO and co-founder of Trade Cloud. Many of our customers already know that, but there's probably some new people on the line who'd love to hear your 1-minute pitch about Trade Cloud. Well, it looks the timing that Matthew is immediately frozen. Sorry, so, Matthew, you froze. Thank you. Could you kick off again? You froze.
I am in Switzerland. So Trade Cloud is a bespoke communications platform designed specifically for the commodities industry. We began about 4 years ago and initially built a negotiation tool, which allowed producers, consumers, and traders to meet, to negotiate and end up with a digitally signed contract, all in a very secure environment. Subsequently, earlier on this year, we rolled out our energy offering, covering oil, gas, and coal products. And in the summer, we rolled out the Trade Cloud Commodities Web, which basically handles all the post-trade communication during the life cycle of a physical trade. This part of the platform is all on blockchain and allows us to link all service providers, all stakeholders in the trade cycle on a shared ledger. And it also allows us to connect to best-in-class companies, such as the ones that are about to be introduced to you.
Fantastic. Thanks, Matthew. I gave you an extra 15 seconds because of the delay there. So no problem with that one. Thank you.
Very much.
We're also joined today by Carl Wegner. Carl is CEO at Contour. And again, many of our customers know already what Contour is out there doing. But Carl, perhaps you want to give us the 1-minute elevator pitch.
Thank you. And thank you for the opportunity to be here with a bunch of new and old friends. Contour is a network of banks, corporates, and technology providers that helps uses blockchain to help customers solve a problem, making trade finance easier to do. So we make trade finance more efficient, secure, using blockchain technology built on R3 Corda. We started out a couple years ago as a project between 8 banks who later invested in Contour and some of the biggest banks in the world, HSBC, Standard Chartered, ING, Citi, BNP, some regional banks as well, and came together to look at the first product being letters of credit and how to make letters of credit more efficient. We work, so that's our first seed product to seed the network. The network has gone from 8 to 28 banks, and we've launched in production at the last quarter of this year. We also work with technology partners, such as TradeCloud, Bolero, and others, to bring data into the network to, again, have data inheritance, right? If it's keyed in once, it shouldn't be keyed in twice. And we should all be helping our customers at the nexus, and we should be sharing data to make a transaction cleaner, quicker, more transparent.
Thanks. Thank you, Carl. Thank you. Yeah, and we're looking forward to seeing how what you've learned through the last few years fits into the dialogue today. Thanks a lot. Also joining us from Rombie, Prem. Prem Sanathan, you are the Director of Marketing at Rombie. But I'll introduce you to give the pitch, please. You've got just over 1 minute.
Thank you, Daf. It's a pleasure being here. So I think most of the gentlemen here talked about digitization and transparency of the transactions. And Rombie here is actually doing the same thing when it comes to the physical. So what we do is we are helping companies get visibility from door to door, irrespective of the mode of transport they use. And the way we do it is through a few pillars. We got a sensor which goes with the consignment. It can be dropped at any location and we pick it up once it's done. We also have an analytics layer, which basically makes sense of all this data that's collected, the location and condition data, so you can predict what's going to happen before your consignment arrives. And lastly, we also have a control tower, which uses all of this actionable intelligence, because most of the companies don't do much with the intelligence just presented to them. And they actually make sure that there are no hassles in the end-to-end transportation. So that kind of gives you a summary of what Rombie does.
Thank you very much, Prem. Looking forward to hearing more. Okay, and our final partner that I'd like to introduce at this point is Andrew Raymond, who's CEO of Bolero. Andrew, why don't you give us the 1 minute pitch for Bolero? Oh, 1 second. I think you need to unmute.
Classic mistake. great to be here today. So Bolero, we're entering our 22nd year of operation this year. We're providing multi-bank, but also EBL services to the community that we serve, which is currently over 200 carriers, 68 banks, and we have a proven process, but also a very proven rule book and a very high level interaction with all of the stakeholders from ICC, DSI, the regulatory authorities, et cetera. In the context of what we're talking about today, we're providing the EBL to TradeCloud Web. It's something we've been doing with Contour for a long time, as well as one of our other pioneers in Singapore, TradeFlow Capital. But also, in recent times, we've signed up other players like DLT Singapore, IncomeLend, LC Lite, ComChain, Envoy, and a unicorn, which was to be announced, and others. So from a corporate perspective, you'll be able to consume the EBL service across multiple platforms and manage it. I guess similar to Prem, like a control tower concept, you'll be able to see all of the EBLs in flow from one central point with Bolero. And certainly pleased to be here and contribute to the panel.
Thank you, Andrew. Now, we're all excited to have these four partners together in the room. And, you know, in the spirit of openness, we want to discuss with our customer base what it is we're trying to do together. Why have we formed this partnership? And what's the value that we bring, particularly to the customer, by doing this? With that introduction and the context of what each partner does, I'm sure we'll go into more detail. I'm going to kick off with the discussion now. Setting the scene, as I did before, with the technology cycle that we're in a really exciting place for our exponential technologies. We're involved in technologies that we all hear of every day, blockchain, cloud, IoT, and so on. And with things like 5G and other technologies around the corner, we're positioning ourselves to enable our customers to adopt those technologies where it makes sense. It's a really exciting place. We were all proving our use cases. We've built functionality. Our communities are building. And 2021 is really going to be the next phase of growth for technology, particularly in commodities. And it's about to start. It's a few weeks away. So Matthew, with what you see at Trade Clouds, you know, could you give us some overview of what you think those next steps are, particularly next year for technology and commodities, and what it is that Trade Cloud with its partners is doing to make that happen?
Yeah, I think the clear message today is that technology is available, it is working, and now really adoption is the most important step. In other words, we've previous webinars, obviously, there have been many frauds, many problems in the industry with the adoption of the technology. I mean, I look at my screen here and I see experts in their in the areas of e-documents, 22 experience this company has, Bolero has been working. So for us to have connected services so that we can offer our customers the opportunity to make use of Bolero's platform within the Trade Cloud Commodities Web to make use of goods tracking through Roam B, or to have your letter of credit digitalized through Contour, I think is a very powerful tool. I think it was a very futuristic idea 20 years ago for Bolero to embark on their journey. And maybe 20 years ago, we did the connectivity that we do today in terms of speed of internet, everybody using digital solutions for the rest of their lives. And yet here we are in commodities, still relying on something called email, largely. And we've seen over the numerous conversations we've had with customers and other industry participants that email simply is no longer a tool. On top of that, everybody's got inboxes of 30,000, so it's very difficult to find things. So for us at Trade Cloud now, having released the commodities web, having provided a secure digital solution for all your communication, it's now all about these connected services. So we are putting into place, as we speak, the development to link the Roam B platform, to link Bolero, be looking to stop with Trade Cloud, but also they will add additional connected services. And when we started these discussions, it really was all about kindred spirits. It felt very good to speak to these gentlemen because they all have the same vision. So we all have a lot of expertise in what we do. So Simon and I, and you as well, Daf, we've been in the commodities trading industry for decades. The other gentleman will also show that's really what we're trying to do, put the best in class around us. What I would say now is what we're looking to do, aside from this collaboration and connected services, We're looking for our customers to use the platform and to engage with us and to give us feedback, to tell us, what are your pain points? Okay, because we have now different companies on this page, on this screen, who are all out to try and make commodity. Okay, and by engaging with us and saying, you know what, I've got this problem. What do you think we can do? We have the expertise in the industry of commodities, but we also have the expertise technology and what technology is coming around the corner. Okay, so together we are all stronger, not just the people on the screen here, but with the customers. We can really brainstorm together, what are the future problems? What are the pain points today? We can provide technological solutions and make the world better for everybody. I remember when I started out in this business 25 years ago, I was a traffic operator. And I remember shipping concentrates to the end receiver, and the end receiver couldn't pay for them. So I put them in a stockpile. I also put blister in a stockpile once. Now, if I'd have had a nice Romby device tucked in amongst my blister, I would have known that they'd been taken without my knowledge. Okay. Now, today, it's possible to have that Romby beacon tucked in amongst the stockpile so that if the goods are begin to be moved without my or my bank's say so, I know about it and I can stop it. And that builds trust, and it reduces the inherent risk of trading commodities. I'm very pleased that Bolero now, with their e-documents, have really seen this year a huge increase in the uptake of people looking at e-documents, because I don't know how many times during my career I was sweating over whether discharge my cargo. If it's a short voyage, I can no longer do a letter of credit, for example, because documents have got to go from one bank to another. Okay. Why do we persist with paper when the technology is there for the electronics? As well, if you look at Contour, again, if you're relying on paper, you're relying on post. You not only have trades, basically, do not necessarily go from party A to party B, but they go around the houses to five different parties. Again, it reduces the possibility of using tools such as letter of credits if you have those time constraints. Okay, so what Carl has done is to basically produce a digital solution to a problem. Okay, and that's all very much a common theme for all of us as kindred spirits. Okay, and the message to everybody listening today is, we're here to help you. Please adopt us, try us. You'll find that technology really does help once you get over the initial inertia. And as I say, we're all stronger together. And I don't know whether that's 5 minutes, 8 minutes, or 10 minutes, Daph.
7 minutes and 4 seconds, minus one or two disconnections, which you carried very well. Thank you, Matthew. No, look, I mean, taking that point about bringing together services to create additional added value for everyone, and then saying, well, look, bring us the problem, bring us the pain points, you know, came through very, very well. And I'd like to sort of point out, you know, again, looking to the past to predict the future, the convergence of technologies is really what made things like electronic banking and payments on the internet work. And, you know, in the example of ride sharing or taxi booking online, bringing GPS and peer-to-peer networks together, bringing those technologies together and those solutions together to solve pain points, you know, was really what happened there to make everyone's lives better. And we're looking to do that, aren't we? When with our different solutions and different technologies converging around our customers' pains. That message comes through very clearly. One thing that comes through quite clearly in the dialogue as well, sort of moving on to our next theme here, is a a challenge that's often raised, which is around standardization. You know, it doesn't really come in the form of an objection, but more an interested question from the communities that, well, how can the technology work without standardization in our processes across the industry? And I find myself with the customers often leading into a discussion about, well, technology can itself drive that standardization by enabling best practices, bringing everyone onto the same page. But on the call with today with us, Carl, you know, with your experience at Contour, I think it would be really interesting to hear from your point of view. You've executed many proof of concepts, live trials, live deals. And in the space of letters of credit, you've been having this conversation a lot, obviously, because of the nature of your customers. What is it that, based on your experience, are your thoughts around this standardization point? Is it a challenge? What are the steps that we need to take, and how do we approach this topic?
No, it's a great question, and something that, you know, we've been talking about for quite a while. Before being in Contour, it was at R3, and a lot of time was spent in the early days of enterprise blockchain trying to decide what was going to be the standard. What about interoperability? Well, we sort of discovered that you can't really have interoperability until you have something to interoperate with. Right? There were no platforms built on blockchain. You didn't know how it was going to run. So until you have scale, till you have something to, you know, information, customers to work together, then you need interoperability. Now, standards, of course, are important. I think that when we talk about, you know, international trade, you know, standards are what keep things going and allow people to do transactions globally. I mean, letters of credit, 11,000 banks on SWIFT. Every bank does letters of credit the exact same way. And what we decided when we decided to launch Contour was to focus on specifically working on letters of credit. Why? Why? Because they're a standard that everyone uses. Now, we didn't change letters of credit. We changed how they're done. But the rule book for letters of credit, UCP, EUCP, every letter of credit issued on our platform falls under the same ICC regulations. And so therefore, we haven't changed that. We're not trying to educate the world on a completely new product that everyone has to adopt, that you have to have hundreds of thousands of corporates and, you know, thousands of banks to adopt a new standard to do something new. So it's a little bit the difference between invention and innovation. Innovation is taking something that exists and making it better. Right, so we've innovated letters of credit by making them more efficient, making them transparent, making that all parties in the transaction to be able to see a digital piece of paper that's being updated. Everyone sees it as it moves around the ownership of the transaction. Everyone can see it at the same time. It's updated instantly on everyone's platform. So you don't have to wait for it to move. Like you said, short shipments, right? You have a short shipment and you know, it takes 2 days to ship and it takes a week to get the paper there to catch up with it, right? It shouldn't be that way. Mm-hmm. It's like getting an Amazon, you know, Amazon Prime. You get the package the next day, but you have to wait for someone to mail you a letter to allow you to open it, right? It doesn't make sense. So I look at, you know, standards, we can leverage them. And we are using the existing standards to build better products or make products, you know, work in a better way. Now, in terms of standards in the industry standards, I think a lot of work has started to be done on standards of, you know, electronic bills of lading, you know, and I'm maybe sure Andrew can talk about that as well. And again, how do we get those standards to make sure that everyone understands the title transfer, right? There's some standards. And some of that is already been built, and a lot of that is being built now. But I think we don't want to wait for the perfect, you know, if we wait for all the standards to be done and don't do anything, we're not going to get anything done, right? I think about my experience in 2005, I think it was. I was at another startup doing trade finance, and there was the APAC digital paperless trading initiative in 2005, and all of APAC countries were going to be digital by 2007 for international trade. And then it was 2009. And then everyone sort of forgot about it, right? Because everyone was trying to spend time building the standards, but they didn't talk about working together.
Mm.
So I think the key is to look at standards, and we need to build them, but also think about what is happening out there. Build something, do something, and then adapt the standards so that it fits what exists in the market. Mm. You just start with the standards, you don't have a product.
Mm. Yeah, thank you, Carl. I mean, that's you're making me think of a quote we like to go back to, that the future is something to be achieved, not predicted, right? And that implies you do something. We find ourselves talking a lot at TradeCloud about this being a journey. You try and take the first steps in the right direction. You don't try and go to the goal. And quite frankly, in our industry with this technology, it's moving so fast, we can't know what the goal is, right? We just need to define what steps we need to take. And I think your analogy of, you know, standardization, if you wait for it, means you don't do anything, is a great one. We need to achieve that. We need to do that. We need to go on the journey. The other thing you said to me last week, which in our conversation, which really made the penny drop for me, was that you innovate, you don't invent. And I found that to be quite a freeing comment, because it made me realize, okay, this is not something that needs to be educated across. This is not something that everyone needs to change their processes and approaches to achieve. It's an innovation on top of what's already there, and we start that journey. So yeah, points well taken. And we've talked now about the dream with Matthew of convergence of the technologies to solve pain points. And we've talked with Carl around, you know, the industry-wide potential blockages or freeing approaches to standardization. I'd like to bring it down a little bit to a lower level now with Prem. Prem, you know, we're talking about removing industry pain points. So let's talk about an industry pain point. What's clear before we do that is that tech is a huge opportunity to manage pain points. If you look at a challenge or an opportunity anywhere in the world, in any industry, you'd be remiss to not look at technology right now to see if you can fix it. It's not the only thing, but we need to look closely at those opportunities. The big pain point, there are many in the commodities industry, but everyone's talking about fraud. Now, fraud for me comes down to visibility. People try to do things that are fraudulent because they can get away with it, because people can't see it. If it can be seen, you won't get away with it. Now, Rombie's in the business of delivering visibility to its customers, right? That's what you do with asset tracking, device monitoring, and so on, putting your bees on assets that move around the world and giving real-time information. What's also really interesting is that you are cross-industry. You've been working in multiple asset classes across multiple industries, and there's probably quite a lot of lessons learned from fast-moving industries that us dinosaurs in commodities could pick up on. So we're quite interested to hear you know, what you have to say. We have a couple of questions actually coming in for Rombie. So, you know, perhaps you can build into your answer this question. You know, my question is, what are your thoughts on how connecting the services of Rombie to other platforms can create visibility for our customers and reduce those inherent risks of fraud? And the questions that's come in for Rombie are around geofences. You know, the customers online that have been asking, you know, could you explain what a geofence is? So perhaps you could build into your answer around creating visibility to tackle fraud, you know, how a Rombie geofence fits into that.
That's a very interesting question. Let me begin with the pain point that you talked about, which is fraud, right? And but before I answer that, I'm going to talk about the fact that, you know, probably the commodities industry is not as much of a dinosaur that you talk about, because I think we all have gentlemen here on the call who are already digitizing most of the box. So Rombie, I would say, is probably fixing one of the hardest problem in your industry, which is actually digitizing the physical. Because here you're not talking about someone sitting behind the computer and writing algorithms of codes, or, you know, or ensuring the standards are met. You're actually talking about ensuring that all the inventory that is lying at a warehouse, lying at a yard, or in transit is visible to you in real time. And to do that, it's very challenging, because you need to have the right kind of connectivity at the place where your sensors are deployed. You need to be able to manage a lot of these data points that are coming in. A lot of times there are certain data points which the sensors don't collect. A good example of this would be weather. Another example of this would be, figuring out whether the commodity is actually made it on the ship or not, because the location can tell you that, you know, it's on the port, but in reality, the container could be on the ship. And if it's on the ship, it's good. If it's not on the ship, then you have a problem. But how do you find that out, right? So you need to be able to now merge your sensor data with other data streams, which is provided by your carriers, by your ports, by your airlines, and so on, right? And now assuming that this hard problem of getting visibility from door to door, irrespective of the mode of transport that the commodity is shipped on, is achieved, the next problem that comes is the problem of data deluge, as I like to call it. Because if you're going to convey a lot of information to your user, they're going to get very confused. For example, knowing that there is X amount of inventory lying in, say, the port of Kuala Lumpur or Port Klang in Kuala Lumpur, or, you know, say, the JNPT port in Mumbai, is not very actionable because they cannot do much with it. But if you can figure out that there are these 5 barrels out of these 5,000 which are actually lying in a location where it should not be lying, then you're able to provide that intelligence that there is something wrong that's going with it, right? And this intelligence comes out of taking all of these data points, cleansing them, weaving patterns out of them, using a lot of AI and machine learning so that you can predict and predict very reliably so, right? So if you look at this whole picture of what you need in terms of visibility, you don't just need visibility, right? Visibility can be any type of visibility. You can get through a GPS device in a truck, but the minute the truck passes on that load to the port, the visibility is gone. What you really need is reliable visibility and actionable visibility. And that's where we have been investing a lot of efforts on our hardware, software, and of course, service. Because after getting all of this intelligence, if there is nobody looking at this and making sure that an incident is not averted, or if there's a delay in the shipment, you are not fixing it on time, then the purpose of the sensor data and the analytics that you get are all lost. So coming back to FraudDAF, I would say visibility can actually solve a lot of pain points in your industry. Like the geofences that you talked about, there's a lot more. For example, if you're looking at double financing, it's something that we had discussed in one of our conversations. If you know that your physical goods are intact where they need to be, then that can be stopped. There was an example that Carl was talking about here, which is the letter of credit that arrives after the goods arrive. So this is another aspect. It may not be related to fraud, but it's a pain point wherein you are actually trying to ensure that the goods that you ordered are ready for manufacturing. You spent a lot of time using the Trade Cloud platform, striking the contracts, making sure that the commodities that you order are of top quality. But if that top quality product does not make it on time for your manufacturing, then there's a big problem, because a lot of times you're running an idle manufacturing plant and the cost of that could be maybe 10 times as much as the cost of the commodities that you ordered, right? Talking about quality again, the quality of the commodity also, once it's dispatched by the seller to the buyer, is also something that's very important to monitor in transit. So if you look at food commodities, for example, fruits, if you're looking at cocoa, a lot of these commodities may be sensitive to environmental conditions like temperature, pressure, and so on. So if you have you have information ahead of time that there is something going wrong with this, you would be able to either rescue the product and solve the problem before it arrives at your plant, or even if you're not able to rescue it, you know 2 to 3 days before that this stock is not going to arrive. So if you look at this overall, fraud is just one pain point that you can solve. I would say that's probably not going to happen most of the time. It's something that you're looking at, you know, it could be 1%, 5% or 10%. But the real pain point that visibility solves in this industry is ensuring efficiency. So going back again to Carl's example here is if your letter of credit is stopping you from moving forward in your supply chain process, so is the fact that your goods haven't arrived or not arrived on time.
Yeah. Thanks, Prim. I mean, it's, you know, I particularly picked up on the reliable and actionable visibility, right? It's taking that place from, you know, data to information that you can take action upon. You know, I think that on the fraud piece, and you bring up sort of double financing and so on, that the yes, Matthew.
Sorry, I just wanted to maybe address this geofence part, because I was very interested in this specifically for metals. As I said, I've been a victim of material being taken when it was under the control of the bank or under the control of me. And basically what the Roamby platform allows you to do is on the platform, you'll have a location on a map form, which you can zoom in on. You can basically draw a border, which effectively then becomes a geo. You've got a B, which is something maybe this big, and that sits in the inside the geofence. And you can put these little devices called beacons, which are about the same size as a domino. You could maybe slip that inside sheets of cathodes or something like that. And basically then when the goods are moved, begin to be moved without your authorization, Roamby, basically the connection is broken. You can see it's gone through, okay? And if you're using Trade Cloud Commodities Web as your digital shipment file, you'll get an alert from Roamby to say your goods are moving, okay? And then you can action it. So I just wanted to make that clear from a metal guy's perspective. That's how it works.
Yeah, it's actually.
I think you explained a Roamby use case better than most Roamby people could. but I think you're spot on there, and I think the value really comes with the interoperability with the platform. So if you know that your contracts are intact, you know that the inventory is intact, and you know that your financial transactions are intact, I think that's when the true power of this can be realized, to your point, Matthew.
Mm. I think when TradeCloud sort of set off on this journey, you know, at the beginning, Matthew and Simon Collins and the other founders, you know, they always had this vision of tying the physical to the contract. Right. And, you know, actually being able to say that in the communications world around the business is inextricably linked to where the actual physical is, which is, you know, sort of what we're talking about here. And this convergence of the two technologies is exactly, you know, what we're able to do in multiple use cases. The frauds that we brought up, there were over the last 2 years, at least over 18 major frauds in the commodities industry, many of them having a negative financial impact in the billions of dollars. And, you know, the majority of them faced around this double financing or just fraudulent creation of a document that didn't reflect a real deal. Now, in both of those cases, in the case that the trader creates a fake physical contract, there's no physical tie to the physical good. So the financing bank wasn't able to see, is there an underlying collateral to this particular transaction? Because that capture wasn't made digitally and it wasn't tied to the physical goods. In the case of the double counting, where someone wants to finance goods in multiple lines with a bank, for example, again, that physical document exists, but there was no actual connection to the physical material that meant that those people could go to multiple banks and finance the same material over and over. And that's the you know, two really good examples that come down on the actual major frauds that we've seen in our industry being solved by taking the digital recognition of the contract and tying it to the physical goods through these two technologies. It's a big challenge. But look, and in, I think we sort of talked about now, we've sort of come from the high level dream and we're coming lower down. And one of the things that Matthew brought up at the very beginning was around adoption. And you know, the adoption of platforms and new technology has been growing. You know, 2020 has been a good year, I think, for many of the different platforms that are providing a real value to the customers. There's a question actually coming in that I'm going to feed into the question for Andrew at Bolero. And the question that's come in anonymously is, you know, at a recent conference, Rio Tinto stated that one of the biggest side effects of COVID was the adoption of e-documents. And, you know, the question is, how has that impacted Bolero? And it's a good question. It's, in fact, we had a similar conversation, Andrew, and you said, well, look, yes, but actually adoption is a bigger picture as well. You know, there's more to it than just the pressure of COVID. And you have some really interesting thoughts about what you're doing to achieve that. What we've seen is a concerted effort by corporations in 2020 to assess the options available to them. At TradeCloud, we've been through many more processes of appraising our product with companies who are going through a strategic review of what's available to them. That signals an increasing appetite to adopt. And we think that 2021 is going to be the year to do that. But what do you think, Andrew, through your experiences at Bolero, you know, what is it that's going to make this adoption work, not just for us, the technology vendors and service providers, but also for the customer?
Great, thanks. And yeah, it's very interesting. And Matt mentioned earlier this idea of kindred spirits, really. And I guess, you know, really, I think what's required is really for us as providers of solutions to join hands and work together in a fundamentally different way. From a corporate perspective, I think what they see is nice solutions, kind of an inch wide and a mile deep. So they get a lot of value from that particular process, but they're very disjointed, and it's very hard for somebody in the operations or finance team to navigate through multiple applications, different logins, all this kind of different kind of protocols, different standards, which Carl alluded to. So I think, you know, there's a time now for us really to think about the problem from a corporate perspective, to work together fundamentally in a different way. And this is really at the heart of what we're doing. We've rebuilt our platform to provide a much better corporate user experience, as well as the banks participating in our platform. We built up robust APIs around that so that everyone can transact purely digitally if they'd like to. And this is what we're using with all of our integration efforts. But you know, at the end of the day, it's not a technology problem, it's a business process problem. Mm-hmm. Hopefully now the penny is dropped with the corporates that transacting on paper is no longer better than going digital. And really, those folks on the call and listening to this message, please take action. Please go out there, investigate, and do something. Don't just rely on paper anymore. This is the thing that's holding the whole industry back. So the more adoption that's happening from the corporate side is going to be better for everyone as we go along. Our strategy is really different than what we've done in the past. It's a completely different approach. So we're working openly with new business models and with all kinds of players in a new way. The whole idea is to provide a joined up experience to the corporate finance person who's using these platforms so they don't have to log in multiple times to access multiple applications or services. So in the context here, we're providing services to Contour, we're providing services to TradeCloud Web and all these other providers. We also are looking to provide services like Track and Trace and the items that Prem is talking about, because it makes sense. We are a nice place where we can join up the physical and financial flows to provide a unified picture, reduce risk, make the whole process much safer and more convenient. This will move us on into the proliferation of digital payments related to trade, which is the other part of this. So further on in the transaction life cycle, the LCEs actually end up in payments or payment commitments. And we're participating with Marco Polo and other providers to look at innovating in that space as well. So we have a new program. We have a new approach. One of the things we announced last year was the partnership with TradeStream. So that will go into production this coming year. And then our newer partnership with Mintigram. And again, both of those are nice examples of where we're partnering up with like-minded companies to build out a more feature-rich platform that people can access much easier. So again, I implore those corporates in particular, if you're on the fence, do some investigation, come talk to us. And all of the technology providers out there, I think we need to work together in a much different way than we have in the past.
Stealing some of the phrases that you used when we spoke recently, Andrew, that really resonated with me. It's all about providing the services in a more joined up way for the customer, and you also talk about extending the functional footprint to customers. The reason why I'm bringing this up is I'm monitoring the questions that are coming in, and a couple of people are saying, well, do I need to sign up for these separate services independently? And it's a great question, because it's exactly what we're walking towards. We're saying, look, if you sign up to Bolero, you're getting Trade Cloud and you're getting Contour. We're lowering the barrier to, collecting those services together. And as you put it, extending the functional footprint, which has always been vision, but now we're able to actually, actually apply it. The other thing, and it's a good way, I think, of pulling the conversation towards a conclusion, I'd like everyone to sort of contribute here, but it's come up twice, same person and a different person asking the question, what are the next steps? And we get this all the time. We expected this question. It's like, okay, big picture, and then you brought it down to a little bit more of a granularity for us. But when I turn off this webinar and I'm at my desk, what do I do next in order to progress on this journey? What I'd like to do is sort of open up that question to all four of you. Let's go through one by one and create the dialogue. But ultimately, as a customer, what are my next steps on this journey? Matthew, what are your thoughts on that?
Well, I think whether you join the digital journey or not, I think it's inevitable that the industry will progress along this digital journey. The question I think you need to ask yourselves is, do you want to do it before you have an issue with fraud or as a reaction to it? So being proactive, I think, is very important. As Andrew said, really educate yourselves on what is available today, because whilst we're all very active promoting our products, the easiest way to do it, and as the whole world is now used to Zoom seemingly, book a remote demo. And that can be done through any of the links on social media or on the websites themselves. But the technology is there today. We all are experts in our fields. We firmly believe that the execution of physical trade is better with these products. As they become joined together in connected services, we're just going to get stronger and stronger and a better and better solution. So join us as part of the journey.
Carl, what are your thoughts on that one?
Yeah, I would say, obviously you said, people are looking now with COVID at digital advising, and it's a need to maintain your supply chains, to keep the business going. But I think it's really next steps. Look at your ecosystem, right? Because it's a journey and it's a team sport. You can't do it by yourself, right? So, not only talking to providers, but look at your own ecosystem. who are the parties that you work with most? Who are the parties that are most progressive? Because you can't start with everyone at once, right? You can't boil the ocean. So choose your counterparties that you want to take on this journey with you, whether they're corporates, whether they're banks. And then when you choose, you find those that group, then look at what the problem you want to solve. And then again, come to, you know, any of the providers here or others that have solution to that problem. But I think you have to look at who you're going to work, you're going to go on this journey with, because you can't do everyone at once. And so choose the corridors, choose the commodities, choose the type of business that makes sense for you. Maybe it's the 80-20 rule, but it's also who you want to learn together with, because it's a learning process.
Thank you, Carl. Yeah. So Prem, you know, in terms of that, then, you know, making the right, not just the next steps, but the steps in the right direction, and making them bite-sized in a way that makes it sensible for your business by looking at your business. You know, what from your point of view would be, you know, the most important next steps for someone who wants to embark on this journey?
Def, maybe I'll talk from a visibility context, because the other gentleman in the panel talked about getting on board with, you know, the digitization of physical trade. I think we have to understand the evolution of visibility here for a moment. Visibility was very hard to get and deploy a few years ago. For example, the model where visibility was being deployed was what was called the connected fleet model. And the connected fleet model is where all the carriers in the process, which is basically your trucks, your airlines, your ships, your ports, visibility was being implemented at these places. And by virtue of your goods passing through these points, you were able to get visibility data from all of these sources. What companies like Roambee have done is we are working towards enabling visibility on demand without relying on the warehouse for visibility, or the yard, as Matthew described for visibility. You can get going with this visibility in a matter of days. It's on demand. There is no sensor purchase. It comes to you where you need visibility. And once your use case no longer exists, we pick it up again. Right. And same thing with shipment monitoring. You get your visibility package at the origin, you deploy it, and once your commodities reach the end destination, we have it picked up. So this on-demand visibility model that's available today because of companies like Roambee, and there could be other people also doing it, you don't have to think twice to deploy it just because it's one transaction or it's one risky commodity that you are actually working with, right? So the barrier to entry, like you said, Daf, is very low today. So I would encourage everyone to think about deploying visibility and then looking at the benefit it brings as part of the digitization in the physical trade ecosystem.
Thank you. Thank you, Prem. Okay. Andrew, is there anything that you would add to this for all of our customers listening about what their next step should be? Click the mute for us. Once again, there we are.
Great, thanks. So, I think that, you know, getting the corporates to move forward and take this as a call to action to do some investigation, look at their own ecosystems, which Carl mentioned is very important. One of the questions that I see came up was whether the corporates would need to sign up independently with the different companies to take advantage of these services. In my opinion, or at least our vision, what we want to do is be embedded in Trade Cloud. You know, those Trade Cloud members who want an EBL service, they just sign up to Trade Cloud. It's very simple. We'll take care of all the stuff behind the scenes. And similarly to Contour and the other providers, and Roambee's got something really cool. It would be so good for our users to be able to track their containers through the process. I mean, it's just such an obvious benefit. Mm-hmm. I think that's where overall working together, we provide a much more compelling use case and a much easier working environment. And digitization then, I think, will move a lot faster.
Thank you.
So there's a bit of work on our side we need to do to work closer together, which I think is really glad to see that that's happening now. Mm,
thank you. Well, look, I mean, really, I think some of the take homes we want for people to take is, you know, we believe that interoperation is going to be a key success factor for companies adopting technology, converging these technologies together to create value. And that's why TradeCloud, Contour, Roambee, and Bolero are partners, but we like to put it a different way. We're investing for our customer. You know, we're investing, we are building now. We are putting our own time, effort, and funds into interconnectivity between our platforms so that they work. This isn't just a vision, this is happening now. And it's going to be happening into 2021, and you'll start to see the benefits of those connected services that we're talking about. Ultimately, what we're trying to do is reduce the effort and the cost for our customers to get on board. You know, we've got proven platforms, we're solving use cases, we know what we're doing. But then once you're on board, we're now part of the same conversation. We can talk, we can understand your problems, we can understand your pain points. As Matthew put it at the beginning, let's work together to solve those within a community where we're all on the same side of the table. We've covered the standardization conversation and visibility, and Prem very cleverly put this as reliable and actionable visibility, not just visibility for visibility's sake. And we've talked about the fact that reducing these effort to onboarding yourselves on our platforms. If you join Contour, you join TradeCloud the other way. If you join TradeCloud, you join Bolero, and Roambee is present all the way through, meaning that adoption is a much less difficult challenge to take on for our customers. I think the final point really to make is that we're here for a conversation. You know, we wanted to explain why we're doing this, not just for our companies, but for the industry, and leave it as a call to action to get in touch with us. We're a team, the people you see in front of the screen. We're easy to get a hold of through LinkedIn, through our websites. You can get a hold of TradeCloud, Bolero, Contour, and Roambee. And you can talk to all of us about solving this problem together. So please do that. I hope you have a very nice time over the holiday season. Think about what we've said and don't hesitate to get in touch. And let's all work together on this technology wave that's coming in 2021. Okay, thank you everyone who's been on the panel. Matthew, Andrew, Prem, Carl, thanks for taking the time and giving us the information. Thanks for everyone who's joined. And watch this space for our follow-up on the discussion that went on today. Thanks very much.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.